Well, welcome, everyone. My name's Ben Quash, and I'm a Professor of Christianity and the Arts here at King's, and I'm chairing this evening. It's a great delight to welcome you all here. I've actually, having been at King's 7 years, never been in tutus before, but it's got one of the best views, I imagine, in London, and certainly in King's. So thank you to the organisers of the festival for giving us this venue and for all the work that's gone into it. It's a very exciting and unusual conversation, quite how a conversation between five is going to work, and you as well, I hope. I'm not sure, but we'll see. David Dimbleby has his own ways of doing it, but he's got years of experience. But it's also an unusual conversation, not just because there are multiple voices around the table coming from very different disciplinary backgrounds and different sorts of practical expertise, but also because of the special nature of the dialogue, in that it's a dialogue between, as well as a group of people, between a novella, a very early work by Dostoevsky called The Double, a film called The Double, which came out earlier this year in this country, and a set of disciplines that include film studies, English literature, theology and religious studies, and actually, those are the key three ones. So enough from me. I'd like to introduce and welcome our panellists. First of all, on my right, Catherine Wheatley, who lectures in film studies here at King's and runs the MA programme in film studies at King's. She's got a very strong interest in film and philosophy and in continental European film, and one of her primary interests is the way in which Christianity is represented in modern European cinema. On my left, Max Saunders, to whom we owe a great deal, not least the invitation to be here as part of the festival. Max is director of the Arts and Humanities Research Institute here at King's, and in addition to that, one of his areas of research expertise is the work of Ford Madox Ford, and he's the author of a book on Ford Madox Ford, subtitled A Dual Life, which seems very appropriate to tonight's theme. On his left is Rowan Williams, Lord Williams of Oystermouth. All of you, I guess, will know of him as Archbishop of Canterbury, and in many cases, you'll know of him too as one of the greatest theologians of our generation. He was my PhD examiner, and I always slightly sort of flip back into that slightly awed mode whenever we meet, but it's a real privilege to have Rowan here, and especially on this occasion because he is, I think, one of the most perceptive, sensitive readers of Dostoevsky's work there is, and his book on Dostoevsky is a magnificent and essential read for anyone interested in the author. And finally, on my far right, Richard Ayoade, who co-wrote and directed the film The Double, which, as I said, came out earlier this year. And again, many of you will know Richard for both his directing work. The Double was preceded by another wonderful film, Submarine, which came out a couple of years ago, and indeed for his acting work. And it was quite difficult getting him into the building today, I'm afraid, because various people wanted to take selfies with him. That was a new experience for me, and he handles it with immense grace every time. So thank you all, and please give them a round of applause to welcome them. I hope you've all got your copies, because we'll be referring to specific pages. What I'm going to do, for those of you who might not have your copies with you, and indeed might not even have read Dostoevsky's novella, I'm going to ask Rowan very briefly to begin by telling us what happens.
Well, thank you very much indeed. What happens in any of Dostoevsky's novels is just a little bit difficult to summarize, even a very short one. But I'll say a few words about the novella and its main themes and take it from there. It's a very early work of Dostoevsky's, but interesting partly because in this work he's already floating some of the themes that will recur again and again in his work. And I've compared it sometimes to the stream of consciousness flow that you find in Crime and Punishment. Mystical Yadkin in The Double is at least in his style, a bit of a dry run for Raskolnikov in Crime and Punishment, because we're taken inside the mind of an obsessional, unreliable point of view figure whose story of what's going on to himself is by no means a reliable story. And just how unreliable this is something Dostoevsky is not going to solve for us. It's a really, really tantalizing novella. Mr. Gulyadkin is a put-upon civil servant, the kind of person who appears all over the place, not only in Dostoevsky's novels, but in Russian novels of the 19th century generally. As many commentators have said, virtually every Russian novelist worth his salt in the 19th century wrote about put-upon civil servants. We begin with a sort of conventional picture of Mr. Gulyadkin murmuring to himself about how difficult his life is, how many enemies he's got, and how people are misrepresenting him. I think that's probably the key to the beginning. He's already somebody who thinks that he is seen wrongly. And it's no accident that on the very first page of the novella, as he gets up in the morning, he looks at himself in the mirror and sees this rather unimpressive, classic, minor civil servant figure. We see, as the first few chapters unfold, that he's somebody with more than usual problems. He knows, or thinks he knows, that his name is being blackened by his colleagues. He goes to visit this rather mysterious and slightly sinister physician, Rutenspitz, a German. He pours out to the physician and surgeon a set of deeply incoherent problems about who he is, what people are saying about him. And so it doesn't come as a complete surprise when, going into the office, he meets his double, referred to throughout the novella as Mr. Gulyadkin Jr. And in this very sort of dry and rather over-elaborate style that he adopts in this novella, Dostoevsky consistently refers to our hero, or Mr. Gulyadkin Sr., and then Mr. Gulyadkin Jr. The new Mr. Gulyadkin, the mirror image Mr. Gulyadkin, is at first very, very respectful, friendly, rather nervous. Gradually he takes over. He puts himself about in the office. His work is recognized, as that of Mr. Gulyadkin Sr. is not recognized. He also, according to our hero, Mr. Gulyadkin Sr., does all sorts of things for which Mr. Gulyadkin is blamed. It can be as simple as eating too many patties in a restaurant and leaving Mr. Gulyadkin Sr. to pay the bill. It can also be much more complex and murky. What exactly has Mr. Gulyadkin, either of them, been up to with various ladies who appear in the novel? Gradually, Mr. Gulyadkin Sr., the man we started with, realizes that he is being literally edged out of his own life into insanity. And the depiction of his obsessional behavior late in the novel, that's where I think it does reach forward to Raskolnikov in Crime and Punishment. We follow trains of thought that are irrational, obsessional, that follow all kinds of tracks. And at the very end, we see Mr. Gulyadkin Sr. being carted off to a mental institution in the company of Dr. Rutenspitz. Or is it Dr. Rutenspitz? As he trundles away in a dark coach on a wet, sleety night, his heart almost stopped beating. Two fiery eyes were watching him in the darkness, and they shone with malignant, hellish joy. This was not Christian Ivanovich, Dr. Rutenspitz. Who was it? Or was it? Yes, this was Christian Ivanovich, but not the same one. A different Christian Ivanovich. A fearful Christian Ivanovich. Instead of a benign, fatherly German physician, surgeon, proto-psychiatrist, you might say, this is some kind of monster. Christian Ivanovich, I think I'm all right, Christian Ivanovich, our hero began in a timid and trembling voice, trying to mollify this terrifying Christian Ivanovich, at any rate a little, by meekness and submission. You will have official quarters with firewood and licht and service which you do not deserve. Christine Ivanovich's answer rang out like the stern and terrible sentence of a judge. Our hero shrieked and clutched at his head. Alas, this was what he had known for a long time would happen. And that's the end. Our hero, whoever he is being whisked away to a mental hospital by Dr. Gutenschmitz, whoever he is. And Dostoevsky has succeeded in dissolving pretty well anything you might call a coherent narrative or a coherent self. And this several decades before Freud. Among many points that have been made about the double is the fact that already in the 1840s, Dostoevsky is describing something of the phenomenon Freud calls splitting. That is, relocating the difficult, the problematic, unacceptable bits of the self onto an externalized other. In this case, literally, a double. And this is where this extraordinary novella stands as a kind of halfway point, a bridge between a particular kind of gothic imagination about doubles and fetches, the sinister double that you see usually just before you die, and Freud's analytical exploration of what it means to externalize your unacceptable self in such a way that you can withdraw from responsibility from your unacceptable actions. So, in conclusion, I think you can say that the double is part of Dostoevsky's passionate and complex and lifelong exploration of responsibility. What is it to be answerable for yourself? Mr. Gulyadkin withdraws from that problem and resolves it by a Freudian splitting, long before Freud. Raskolnikov, in Crime and Punishment, has again to answer the question, what is it to be answerable for your actions? Because he has persuaded himself that his murder of the old pawnbroker in Crime and Punishment is an action which is not only justified, but in accord with the whole dialectic of history. And in the later novels, especially in Devils and Brother Karamazov, Dostoevsky gives his most complex, most mature account of what it is to be responsible, which is not only to take responsibility for your own actions and decisions, but in some rather mysterious spiritual sense to take responsibility for everything and everyone else as well, which is why the hero of his last and longest and greatest novel, Brothers Karamazov, is not the saintly ex-monastic novice Alyosha, but the rather rackety and at first irresponsible elder brother, Mitya, who finally wakes up to the fact that although he didn't in fact murder his father, as everybody imagines he does, he's got to act as if he had, because he might as well have done. His darkest and most murky impulses have to be owned and paid for. So you could see Dostoevsky's fiction as a long trajectory from the splitting that's going on in Mr. Gulyadkin. I can't take responsibility for the unacceptable. I'm soiled by my own desires, my own impulses, and I have to push them out there and pretend it's somebody else. Right through to Mitya Karamazov, who says, the only way of coping with my unacceptable and murky impulses is to act as if I had acted them out and take responsibility for them, and in so doing, take responsibility for, accept solidarity with, the most sinful, the most outrageous characters of all. That's why I think this is more than just a minor early work. I think it's full of all sorts of interesting and important clues, not only for the mature Dostoevsky, but really for understanding the whole of that 19th century and early 20th century bafflement, a fresh complication of understanding about the self itself, and whether we've got one. And if we haven't got one, what we should do about it.
Thank you very much, Rowan. Well, in the same spirit, I know that the film The Double was shown last night, and some of you will have seen it here in King's, but in the same spirit, I'd like to turn to Richard now and ask if he'd give us a sense of the film, and both what happens, and maybe in some respects, too, how it might differ from the novel.
Sure. Well, prepare yourself something much less coherent than that. and I probably can't defend it. But the film has the main character, Simon. We changed the name for box office purposes. Is a lowly clerk in a world that isn't particularly now, but it's not in the future, it's an alternate world, not specified in a time. And he has a similarly lowly function with a oppressive boss called the Colonel. You don't quite know what he does. He has a superior, Mr. Papadopoulos, who doesn't really take him in at any level and is constantly ignoring Simon's attempts to better himself at work. Simon is also enamored of a co-worker called Hannah, who works in the same company. Again, you're not exactly sure what she does other than she photocopies various forms that Simon in some way is involved with producing. And Simon indeed watches Hannah from his room at night and spies on her. After a particularly great humiliation at a company event, the Colonel's ball, Simon has a kind of rupture and of great humiliation and sees his double. His double comes into the office, and as in the novella, no one notices really. One of the things that struck me as particularly funny about the book, and I think it is a very funny book, is that it is unremarkable that this person comes in and has the exact same face to everyone else. And I think only a writer of Dostoevsky's genius would have hit upon that. It's the opposite way you would write that. Normally everyone would remark upon it, it'd be a scandal. But people just go, yeah, maybe he does look exactly like you. What's next? And so Simon, initially again in the film, and his double, who's called James, get on seemingly. Again in the novella, there's a very funny passage where Goliadkin really likes his exact double. There's something very funny about the egotism of meeting his exact replica and going, I think this person's incredible. and again, it's just very funnily depicted. But as with the novella, the double slowly replaces Simon. James takes credit for his work. He starts from a position of helping Simon to perhaps advance his romantic intentions with Hannah to interceding and actually becoming the romantic interest for Hannah. What becomes apparent, and I guess perhaps other than the existence of Hannah in the film as a love interest, which is different to the novella, Simon notices that any physical injury or any mark that attaches to him also attaches to James. And Simon, after an incident where Hannah tries to take her own life and he intercedes, starts to notice that things that affect him affect James. And he hits upon the idea of jumping out of his building, thus killing James and going off. Again, a little like the novella, in an ambulance with the idea, has he killed James or has he merely killed himself? I think that's roughly what happens.
Yeah. That's how I remember it. Thank you very much. I'd love to respond, but I'm going to restrain myself and invite Max and Catherine, first of all, to respond to their readings of either novel or film or both, and perhaps also to the things that Rowan and Richard have said. Catherine, would you like to go first?
Yeah, that's fine.
Sorry, I should just say, you will get a chance to ask questions a bit later on, so don't worry, you're going to have a chance to ask things from the floor, but initially I want to hear from the panellists.
Okay, so I'm going to talk mainly about the film, but I do think the novella, in its use of the doppelganger trope, is in a sense proto-cinematic. And what I mean by this is that it does what good cinema does best, which is to take something about the human condition and to make it into something visual, to give it a body. So it's hardly surprising, given that relationship, that cinema has been absolutely fascinated with the idea of doubles ever since its inception. And that goes from the early silent film, The Student from Prague, right through Ingmar Bergman's Persona to David Fincher's Fight Club, and through to Rich's wonderful film, The Double. Within this fascination, the double can be comic, as in Charlie Chaplin's The Great Dictator. It can be tragic, as in Hitchcock's Vertigo. Most often it's downright sinister, and that's something that a film like Invasion of the Body Snatchers makes very frighteningly clear. And I think one of the wonderful things about the double, both the novella and the film, is that it's all three. And that moment that Rich has just been describing where Goliadkin and Simon, I think, are sort of both utterly enraptured with their doubles when they first meet them, is also something that to me is quite sad and quite moving. And there's a scene in the film where after their big night out of drinking and carousing and chatting up girls, which is something you get the impression that Simon really never does do, James falls asleep on Simon's bed and he strokes his face. And it's a bit creepy, but it's also really quite moving. And I think in a way that theirs is the great love story of the film and the book, and really Hannah, as lovely as she is, couldn't come close to bringing Simon that relief from loneliness that we see in these fleeting moments when he first meets James. And I think that's also why James's betrayal of Simon is such a tragedy at the film's end. Because this is, as much as anything else, a film about loneliness. And I think in that respect, it does differ from the novel in that Simon's problems aren't more than usual. In some ways, they're very usual and something that we can all relate to. We actually only meet James a third of the way through the film's running time, which echoes the book's structure. So up until this point, the film takes pains to really detail quite how miserable Simon's life is. It's a series of failures and rejections that climax in this humiliating expulsion from a party and a declaration that this is not me. He shouts these words, this isn't me. And they're the words that seem to summon James to life. I think in this way, Simon is very typical of some of the other characters that Richard writes. I think back to Submarine. Simon says, you know, I'm permanently outside myself. You could put your hand right through me. And Owen, the protagonist of Submarine, states that he wishes there was a camera following him around all the time. And then we cut to this sort of take where we see Simon positioned from Owen positioned from a distance. And both of the films really capture this this sense of being outside ourselves, of being not quite real. Owen's not fully formed. He's still able to try on identity. So he goes through his hat phase, for example. But Simon's arrived at adulthood, and he's at a point where he seems to just be completely incapable of transforming himself through any kind of meaningful action. Right from the film's first sequence, which takes place on a train, we see him pushed around and put upon by porters, by fellow passengers, even by technology itself. And there's a dreamlike quality, I think, to the film's disconnect between action and results. It's like those nightmares that we all have where we're running and running and running and we just don't seem to get anywhere. And it's enhanced by the film's mise-en-scene and the film's look. It's very dark. I think the film takes place exclusively at night.
Yeah, there's no natural light.
It's all this kind of sickly, yellowy, green, greyish, neon light that seems to seep in under doors and through windows. There are an awful lot of close-ups, and again, I'm not sure that there are many establishing shots.
No.
So we can't get our bearings. I really struggle to orient myself when I watch the film. We might be in a bad dream or in the sort of sickly recesses of Simon's mind. And against this backdrop, James might be a literal embodiment of Simon's self-loathing, or he might be a wistful projection of everything that Simon wishes he could be. In most films featuring doubles, there seems to be, as far as I can work out, an explanation for the double's provenance. So either aliens or sorcerers, deals with the devils, stalkers or schizophrenics. These are the prime culprits. And James seems to surface from beneath the world, in fact. We never really know where he comes from. And one of the things that's so striking about the film is that nobody knows, nobody cares, and they don't even really mind, as Richard's just said, about the fact that he looks so much like Simon. And yet, the characters obviously do look like each other because, well, they do, and also they're able to switch identities in such a way that nobody notices. And I find that kind of paradox quite tricky. It's a bit like a reversing of Louis Buñuel's Obscure Object of Desire. I don't know if you've seen that. Mm-hmm. In which we have two actresses playing the same part and nobody in the film notices it. And the main reason it works here is because Simon and James are played by the same actor, Jesse Eisenberg. There's been a lot written about Eisenberg and his star persona. And I'm not sure that that's necessary as something to think about in order to work out why his casting here is so uncanny in a way. There's a loss when films become, when books become films, in that there's a detail that needs padding out. We lose a sense of mystery. But at the same time, there's an uncanniness that springs from the film itself and from the use of the same actor to play the two roles. So we know it's one actor, and our knowledge of that performance kind of haunts our reading of the film, I think, or our viewing of the film. And there's a sense in which we're constantly asking ourselves how he does it. But more than that, the film compensates for the loss of detail by actually using these details to work in service of that mystery and that uncanniness. So doubling and duplication, symmetry and repetition, they shape the film's very fabric. James's arrival, for example, is prefigured in a number of ways. We have a series of photos hung up on the walls of Simon's office. We have some very precise, symmetrical shots that seem to split the room into two matching halves. There's neurotic Hannah and nymphomaniac Melanie, who form an inverted pair. They're blonde and dark bobs, casting them as negative images of one another. Hannah, whose name is a palindrome and so inverts itself, operates a photocopy machine and draws pictures of herself reflected in a mirror. She is, to borrow a phrase from the great critic Roger Ebert, head-spinningly schizoid. Simon mimics the pose in a portrait of the ominous colonel, who appears as if from nowhere in the film's final shots, and presses a cloth to his face as if to take an imprint in a scene that really reminded me of the Turin Shroud, actually. Lines of dialogue and snippets of soundtrack are repeated. The film opens and closes with a body tumbling from an open window and a grim death, perhaps. Hannah describes the deceased to Simon as a useless nothing of a man who's been moping around after her, just as Simon himself has been. And in the dead man's window, Simon seems to see himself. And of course, later we'll learn that that's James. And at the very end of the film, James will look out and see Simon. So there's this series of doubling that goes on throughout the film. But I think most importantly, and the thing that I find really intriguing about this event, is that the double is, of course, itself a double, because it's an adaptation of a novella. And so what Richard and his co-writer, Ivy Corrine, have done is created a brilliant copy, which arguably, like James himself, comes to outshine the original. And I'm probably not the only person in the room that saw the film before they read the book. So in a sense, I feel like I met James before I met Simon, perhaps. So in part, it succeeds because film has always had an uncanny effect, because it offers us a vision of a world that's both familiar to us and strange at once, and that's built out of images of our reality. But I think in part it succeeds too because of what it does at the ending. It's a real trope within cinematic doubling to have the original commit suicide inadvertently by killing the copy. And actually, the film reverses that idea, and it reverses what seems to me to happen at the end of Dostoevsky's double, because whereas at the end of the novel, Goyadkin fragments further and further and further until he just falls apart, I think there's a possibility in the film, and I may be corrected in a moment, that Simon actually, by smashing himself to pieces in that very final shot, might pull himself together and finish the film not as a non-person, but as an individual whom there is no one else quite like. And so that for me is the sort of real difference that marks the film from the novella, and which asserts a voice that is really rather unique.
Thank you very much, Catherine. And Max, would you like to conclude our initial responses?
Okay, I'm going to conclude by throwing a bit of provocation into the discussion, I think. I mean, Catherine has made a fantastic case, I think, for the intelligence of Richard's film and the fascinating ways that it deals with the uncanny and, you know, those strange effects in the novella. But I was slightly surprised by the way he described his own film. And it made me wonder for a minute whether we hadn't got the wrong person here, that, you know, maybe this is the man from the IT crowd and not the film director. Because you said that, what I want to talk about really is ambiguity and the ambiguity of the appearance of the double. And that idea that when the two Jesse Eisenbergs appear and no one remarks on the similarity, it's right that it produces a wonderful effect on the film, but it's a very different kind of effect from the effect in the novella, isn't it? Where, of course, you know, precisely because you don't see the people, you don't know whether they look the same or not. What I want to ask about is what difference does it make to the novella that we don't know, and that sort of uncertainty, which seems to me absolutely central in it. And of course, I think there are uncertainties in your film, but they have to be elsewhere, don't they? Because, you know, the visual effect is of seeing that the two characters are identical, that they do look alike. And it then becomes very weird that people don't notice that or behave more strangely than they do. When people have written about the double, they've described it in lots of different ways. But it's often seen as a kind of reaction to earlier writings. Rowan spoke about the German sort of romantic, you know, E.T.A. Hoffmann tales. It's also seen as drawing on Gogol's stories about St. Petersburg, of course. When the critic Victor Terrace writes about it, he says that it makes the reader search among conflicting data with increasing frustration in an effort to decide whether the events are the fantasies of an unbalanced character or the presentation of the supernatural as real. I mean, that's really a description of the kind of Germanic Romanticism version. But it makes the Dostoevsky sounds like it's just flipping on a straightforward ambiguity between just two alternatives. Either the double is a mad fantasy of some kind, or the world is much weirder than we try to think it is. But of course, that's too glib. And as Terrace goes on, his two alternatives then sort of multiply slightly disconcertingly into four. And he says, in the double, the morbidly sensitive and pretentious clerk, Goliadkin, already clinically deranged by the social pressures of his office, so that ambiguity, I mean, the idea that we can't be sure whether he's mad or not seems to have gone out of the window already. That he's finally driven to a madhouse by a series of encounters with a being who is, and then he goes through four possibilities. Sometimes clearly his own reflection in a glass, that was the scene that Rowan started with, you know, the idea that the double might be a kind of optical illusion, a trick of the senses. Sometimes the embodiment of his own aggressive fantasies, a more psychoanalytic sort of reading, we might be dealing with the trick of the mind. Sometimes an unpleasant ordinary mortal who just happens to have the same name and appearance, a kind of trick of chance or fate. And sometimes, finally, in some supernatural way, himself. That's rather odd, isn't it? A kind of slightly new agey sense of, you know, meet your inner Goliadkin. So we've got a much wider range of ambiguities, of possibilities, four rather than two. But I think there are other really important ones that are kind of pressing in on the story. One is that one that, again, we've touched on, as the psychoanalyst Otto Rank says in his study of the folklore tradition of the doppelgänger, the double, in sort of folk tales and literature. Seeing your double is generally taken as a presentiment of your own death. You know, hence all those plots where sort of shooting the double then it kills the self. But then finally, of course, the other possibility that's around the peripheries of the story is that there might be something diabolical about this double, that it's, you know, a supernatural manifestation of something evil or tempting. And that would be the version of what Taras calls the supernatural as real, although he tries to sort of tame it as a more psychological thing rather than the avatar of the supernatural other. And the story sort of sets this up in all kinds of ways. Devil take him, Goliadkin says about his manservant, Petrushka, who keeps on not being there. But, you know, maybe that phrase sort of comes back to haunt us. Everybody seems bewitched today, thought our hero. Some kind of devil's got into all of them. And I think that this is interesting, obviously, because it, as Rowan was suggesting at the beginning, it connects the double then with Dostoevsky's other works, not just the novel Devils, obviously, but also, and especially the brothers Karamazov, with Ivan's extraordinary dialogue with the devil in that novel, which also sort of teeters on the brink of, you know, is it hallucination or is it the supernatural is real? The double actually wasn't received very well originally and is less read now than the big books like Crime and Punishment and Karamazov. So I think it's worth showing, as Rowan did at the beginning, how often they're all woven out of the same ideas and predicaments, crises. Dostoevsky clearly thought the double anticipated perhaps his most famous short work, Notes from Underground, when he said in his writer's diary that for all its faults, after it had a bad reaction and he conceded it might have faults, the double, he said, introduces my supreme underground type, which of course is why we're discussing it in this underground festival. So to get back to those various interpretations of the story, the reason I've done that literary criticism thing and talked about several possibilities is because I want to focus on that idea of ambiguity itself. Literary critics often talk as if ambiguity were self-evidently and self-sufficiently a good thing. But why is it good to write a novel or a novella in which the main armature of the plot is so unclear? Could be so many incompatible things. Why doesn't that just make it a vague book, fatally unresolved? Well, perhaps that's what it did feel like to some of those early readers and reviewers who thought it didn't work. But I think the answer is that Dostoevsky's genius is so much to do with keeping in play a multiplicity of perspectives, of voices, of judgments, because of course there aren't just two possibilities in play, and not just six, but innumerable ones, just as the two Goliadkins split and multiply in the end. The terms introduced by Dostoevsky's critics, like Mikhail Bakhtin or Viktor Shklovsky, have foregrounded this, talking about the polyphonic or the dialogic novel, heteroglossia, the sort of, you know, plurality of languages and tongues and voices, the carnivalesque or the parodic. So many voices, many views of the world. And I think this, I mean, it's partly about literary traditions, this, a kind of rejection of realism and romanticism and saying, well, no, it's not like either of those two things, it's more complicated. But of course, that's also a philosophical or theological view of the world. We have religion giving us one account of how we got here and why and where we're going. But we have a scientific view emerging more strongly in the 19th century, telling us a very different and increasingly incompatible story. And Darwin's Origin of Species, for example, appeared in between the two versions, actually, of the double, 1846 and 1866. But there's an emerging sociological view as well, telling us that man is shaped by society, and by anthropology too. And finally, the psychological view that's coming into play increasingly throughout the century, where there's more emphasis on how we perceive the world, what our minds do to it, how our mental experience often seems to correspond neither to the religious nor the psychological nor the social. Many of us, of course, still don't know which of these is the right view of what things are really like, or to what extent any of them can be synthesized. And that's the agnostic predicament. That's what agnosticism means. And for people in the mid-19th century who felt their faith was being threatened by modernity and modern developments in science and psychology and so on, it felt really devastating and overwhelming and depressing. So many narratives of spiritual crisis in the 19th century involve a kind of mental breakdown, very much the kind we see in The Double. And I think that's because for believers, losing their faith or severely doubting it produced a really existential crisis, which might seem odd to us now from the vantage point of a much more secular society. And that's because it wasn't possible to keep religion separate from everything else. It seemed to be the ground of everything else, of human values, of identities, of human lives. So as belief crumbled, so did people's sense of who they were, of how they should live, what their experience was actually like. It was as if the very ground beneath their feet quaked and they felt themselves slipping underground. Rowan Williams' book on Dostoevsky is wonderful on this sense of the interdependence of faith and fiction and how sort of saturated with theology Dostoevsky's work is, particularly Russian Orthodox theology as well. But it seems to me that he wanted, and here I'm going to be provocative again and probably risk being excommunicated as well as defenestrated, but it seems to me that he wants to rescue Dostoevsky from an early comment in one of his letters where he describes himself as a child of this epoch, a child of disbelief and doubt up to now, and even if I'm quite, and even I'm quite sure of it, says Dostoevsky, till the day of my death. And Dr. Williams argues that what the great novels do is show us how terrible a world would be if we lost religious faith. In other words, I think he wants to fold Dostoevsky back into the fold. He's really a believer, despite what he says, and is issuing warnings to the epoch about what we might be losing. Well, I have to say I disagree with that as fundamentally as it's possible for an agnostic to do, I guess, because it seems to me that what Dostoevsky is showing is what agnosticism is like, what it feels like not to know, when we can't know, when we can't be sure. And so we can't be sure what we've seen or what we've felt or even who we are or how many of us there are. So I will pause there.
Thank you, Max. Would you just briefly, before we move on, just say what you think Dostoevsky meant by saying he was the perfect underground type of Goliadkin, chief underground type?
That Goliadkin introduces his underground type?
Yes, he called him, his underground type.
Well, I think it's, yes, I mean, it's a wonderful question that. I mean, it's partly that I think he anticipates the man, narrator of Notes from Underground. But that sense of the character that so many Russian writers were writing about, as Rowan mentioned, they often call it the superfluous man, mm-hmm. didn't they? The man who had no sort of place in society, and Dostoevsky sort of, places that no place underneath everything else, mm-hmm. or sort of as, as if the character is sinking down beneath the world. But I think it's also very much a psychological trope in the way, talking about what we would now call the unconscious. I mean, what is so striking about Goliadkin, as with so many of Dostoevsky's characters, is that we seem to hear their unconscious speaking all the time. Mm. Don't we? Matthew Arnold, at about the same time, had this wonderful phrase for the kind of inwardness or inward turn of the 19th century when he spoke about the dialogue of the mind with itself. And that, you recognise that in a lot of 19th century writers, novelists, poets, sort of being very inward. But with Goliadkin or Dostoevsky's characters, it's not really a dialogue. It's like the mind heckling itself, isn't it? There's this sort of seething, kind of really disturbing sense of voices coming from nowhere and contradicting himself all the time. Mm. And I don't know of any other writer who gets that in a sense. So I think the underground man.
This is an extraordinary sentence from the novel. Rubbing salt in his wounds and taunting himself at that moment gave Mr. Goliadkin a kind of profound pleasure almost amounting to voluptuousness.
Yes,
so the sort of othering of himself in order to actually torture the other. But Rowan, I was at this point going to ask you to comment on the film, but there are certain things in what Max has said that you might want to answer first before you turn to the film.
A couple of things, if I might. One about the sense in which Goliadkin is a proto-underground man. Different kinds of disillusion, different kinds of uncertainty, I think. In Goliadkin, you see uncertainty, if you like, becoming utterly, utterly fragmenting, as was noted, I think, by Catherine earlier on. There was a ringing in Mr. Goliadkin's ears and darkness before his eyes. He imagined that an endless string of Goliadkins, all exactly alike, were bursting noisily in through all the doors of the room. The whole thing is just multiplying in all directions. It's like the Sorcerer's Apprentice cartoon, Disney's Fantasia. Whereas the underground man in Notes from Underground is somebody whose uncertainty is rather different. He's saying, well, why should I believe that 2 + 2 = 4 just because somebody tells me it's rational. Why be rational? That's, you know, that's not where we begin from. We can say what we like, can't we? So that's a much more aggressive kind of in-your-face dissolution, saying, okay, so we're dissolving, so what? And the sheer, what should you call it, the gleeful nastiness of the underground man, where he just says, sod you, to any attempt to rationalize experience of the world, is one of the things that makes that such an extraordinarily satisfying and provoking novella, once again. But just to come back very briefly on your point about Dostoevsky as a whole, I don't think I want to fold him back any more than he himself wanted to be folded back. He was, of course, an Orthodox Christian and made a big show of it, and was, I think, passionately sincere about it. I think what he does in the novels is, again, a sort of doubling thing. He wants to make a strong theological point, and he cannot help himself, because he's a novelist, and a staggeringly good novelist, he can't help displaying irresolution in the actual structure and timbre of the novels. And that's part of, certainly for a theologian, part of the interest of what he's doing, that he's not trying to make it easy for himself. And I wonder whether that relates a bit to the point, the really very powerful point you made about the proto-cinematic quality of Dostoevsky's narrative. I was so pleased to hear you say that, because it's something which I think is absolutely fundamental in reading Dostoevsky. It's cinematic again and again and again. The great climactic scene of Kirillov's suicide in Devils is as cinematic as anything in any European fiction, I think. And that cinematic character, you know, whatever you're trying to do with the images are the images, they are what they are. They exist in their own space, their own visual imaginative world. And I think that's part of what he's doing. And I think that's also part of what the film does, creating its own world, as Richard said earlier on, and creating it, I think, with enormous visual and imaginative integrity, and leaving us with that irresolution at the end. Who's dead is the question that, as it were, flashes up on the screen at the end. And a good film leaves you, I think, with that kind of question. It doesn't, at the end of the credits, say, and the moral of that is. And I think that's the force of the film. I think comparing it with the novella, two things which are interestingly and provocatively different, I think. One is the way in which the whole erotic dimension is foregrounded in a different way. It's there in the novella. It's handled, I think, differently and very successfully, I think, in the film. And that's, I suppose, because what Dostoevsky culturally has to tiptoe around a little bit, we can be a little bit more candid about and foregrounding. I think the thing which I read in the novella that I don't get in the film is exactly the point you made. We begin with a dissolving consciousness in the novella, whereas the film is much more about almost a process of negotiating towards something, towards some action which may or may not resolve it, but it has a dramatic structure in that sense which the novella doesn't quite have. So that perhaps does film have to do that within a shorter period of time than a reading novel takes?
It's an interesting question. I don't know whether they have to, and I think there are films that don't. I think there's a Hollywood version of double films, as you were pointing out, where there's an explanation for a double, which to me is like the ant invasion film model, where 10 minutes in, there's an event that occurs, and so the protagonist, everything's fine, there's a disruptive event that they have to deal with over the course of the narrative, and they either fail or not. I guess Invasion of the Body Snatchers has something of that. Everything's peaceful, aliens come in, how do we deal with it? And with this, as you say, we wanted to keep what was in the novella, which is that the double has to be a manifestation of a psychological situation with Simon. It's not something that occurs to him. It comes from out of his frustrations. I'd say in the novella, what I found was that there's a good deal more pomposity in the character, perhaps.
Yes.
That he's always counting his money. He's far more socially mobile. He has a manservant. You know, there are things that are where he views himself in the middle, and he's trying to go up. Whereas I think in the film, the character, there aren't many people lower than him, and it doesn't feel like there are as many levels that you can go. One of the things that we tried to do in the film was that everyone sort of wears the same suit. There aren't ties, apart from very few people. So, you know, I guess that's a difference in that way. We wanted really, I suppose, with the idea of Hannah, and I realize as I'm saying this, a lot of the things that you're doing are intuitive. I sort of feel almost, and I think you correctly pointed out, almost uniquely unqualified to participate, because a lot of it is going, I don't know, it kind of felt right, this is kind of what we did, rather than from an analytical perspective of, this is our intention, how can we fulfill it? Interestingly, this author I currently have a crush on, George Saunders, he described that when he started writing, he had this sense that a proper novelist had to come with what he called a truckload of meaning, and that the story was a way of getting that into the reader's head. And then he realized that what really happened when he wrote was sentence by sentence. If the sentences, as he put it, jangled, that the meaning would reveal itself somehow to the reader, and perhaps he would discover what the meaning was and discover what the demands of the story were. And I feel Avi and I were similar in that, despite working with a source material, that we weren't hopefully in a monoform way pushing you towards a conclusion that you ought to reach. I mean, in terms of the point of cinema as well as the point that you touched upon, which is we don't know in the novel whether they're doubles, and you know, there's that happens in Despair, although there's a big twist in the Nabokov novel where you think he's the same person, then it's revealed at the end that this person looks nothing like him. I still think it's possible in films to show things and them to be a lie, just because it's a kind of visual proscenium arch in some way medium. Hitchcock had this with, I think it was with stage fright, wasn't it, that there's a, he said that he made this fatal error in that he showed a murder, and later you reveal that that murder wasn't as depicted. Now we watch that and go, that's fine. You know, there's a tradition of cutting away to this, and you can show things differently. Indeed, with Rashomon, you can show the same event from three different perspectives, and that can be very disruptive because there's a sense of verisimilitude with something that is pictorial. So with a camera, because it's that face, that scenery, this is the image of it, and therefore it speaks of a kind of a truth. But what we wanted to do was go, well, the image doesn't have to be truthful. The fact that we see it doesn't mean that it happened necessarily. The fact that we see a two-shot doesn't mean that it has happened. You know, there'd be a way of doing this all POV. Ooh, there we go. We could do it all POV, like Lady in the Lake, and literally just see it through his eyes. But I think cinema's got to a stage whereby you don't have that kind of subjectivity. And what's interesting, I think, in the novella is that it's third person. You know, this could be a first person novella whereby it's the unreliable testimony of this person, but it's not. It flits in and out. So I think that's also what cinema does. It can't, I mean, I don't think Lady in the Lake is a great film, because it tries to just show something from one person's point of view, but I think you don't see the world in that. I think you see the world in cuts. You sort of imagine yourself in a scene even though you can't see yourself, which is why people are so humiliated when they trip over. They kind of go, I can see myself, and now I need to pretend I haven't, and I'm going to get up, and it's okay, and that was part of my balletic movement forward. You sort of pitch yourself in the scene and try and alter it as it goes along. And I think that's how Simon is trying to construct his reality. And so whether we're successful or not is a different matter. But I don't agree that the fact that you see two people in the frame means that that is a reality. I think a film can have a dream, me feel persona, again, is a great example of that.
Yeah, no, that's really interesting. I mean, I think there are also really intriguing ways that you sort of complicate it as you bring it up to date by thinking about identity. I mean, the fact that he loses his identity card in the doors of the underground train and can't get in, so, you know, which makes sort of connects with all our anxieties about identity theft and ID cards and everything. But you know, but does then sort of really raise a question about sort of who he is, what identity is, how many people claiming to be him there might be, and so on.
Well, there's that thing whereby people always delight when they hear of a celebrity not being able to get into a bar, and there's that question of that it's always reported where the person is pushed to say, don't you know who I am? And the reality is, if someone else doesn't know who you are, you aren't that person. You're just some, you're not Keanu Reeves, you're a man in a beanie who could be anyone. And but there's something kind of funny about that question, because what it poses is that identity requires the participation of everyone else in some way. And I suppose one of the things I think we try to do narratively through Hannah, as well as hopefully being a genuine character, was that by his interest in her, and Rowan in his book talks about what do people owe one another, and also the idea of visibility in terms of being a person, that by actually starting to see another person and becoming involved with that person in a genuine way, rather than just viewing them as what Hugh Hefner called blank canvases on which to project your desire, which is how he views women. by his own admission, he literally says, this is why I'm never disappointed if I break up with someone, because they're just blank canvases, and someone else can be that blank canvas. That hopefully by Simon breaking out of that idea of just viewing her as an object of desire, to quote Bonwell, that he can maybe go on a path to becoming a person in some way.
Just following on from that a bit with the novella again, one of the characteristics of Mr. Gulyadkin's internal style and external style is this obsessive use of people's names. He will say someone else's name several times in the same sentence, as if there's a constant appeal saying, I recognize you, can't you recognize me? And the names are like hooks to draw recognition, and of course consistently fail, because it's a story, it's a tragedy in one sense, as well as being very funny.
At this point, I want to open things up a bit to you and give you an opportunity to, you don't have to ask a question, you might just want to make a comment, but either way, please do make the most of this extraordinary group of people and put your hand up. You're sort of in darkness, so you may put it up very visibly as you can.
This one over there.
Right over there by the window. And please just stand and project. Thanks.
I can't recommend my film, you know, as palliative care, but as I don't know. I mean, I've somehow foolishly spoken first, but I think anything in which you some way recognize your, it's not another person in encountering a work of art or an idea or a notion of humanity is of tremendous value.
So one of the things that I was thinking about when I was thinking about tonight was whether actors and celebrities, I suppose going back to Keanu Reeves and his beanie hat, have any special or privileged relationship to this notion of doubling and having a sort of public persona and then a private persona in that seeing oneself as other, and actually as Richard was speaking about Keanu Reeves, the other thing that I thought of was of Twitter handles and people who say the real Richard Ayoade, and there's some way you can be tweeting as whoever you want to be until you're caught. And my point is, I don't actually think that they necessarily do have a privileged relationship to doubling and to having various different identities and seeing ourselves as another person. And I think that's something that most of us are familiar with. So I can't, again, speak to the film or the novella as sort of helping with mental illness, but I think helping with just being a human being, there's something very familiar about that kind of feeling of non-personness that Simon has at the beginning. And every time he starts to say something, like a door whooshes shut or a radio comes on. And I think that frustration of feeling like you're kind of a dog barking at a freight train is captured, I think, maybe more by the film, because I think the novella he is hysterical almost from the outset. And there's this kind of compulsive shopping that he does at the beginning that he never actually buys. And again, it sort of feels like these YouTube hall girls that, you know, bring all this stuff and then take it back to the shop the next day. But the film, I think, certainly does speak to a loneliness and a sense of not being noticed that maybe, at least I feel, is a quite common experience, which is what good art does.
I think one of the strengths of the novella is that it's not tied particularly to a psychodynamic theory. It's, if you like, a portrait of a particular kind of disorder. What you do with it remains, I think, an open question. And what on earth Dr. Rutenschmidt is going to do in his clinic at the end, you know, goodness only knows. And this is 1840-something, after all. But I think it does, as has already been implied, it does challenge the reader by saying, how much of this do you recognize? Certainly, as a reader of it, the internal fugue, the internal fantasy, is something I can recognize as an averagely neurotic person. And that's what makes it worth reading. It increases one's sense of one's own fragility and oddity. It increases some readiness to take seriously other people's accounts of their own fugal and hysterical behavior. Like any good piece of fiction, it increases the sense of the strangeness of the human world we're in. So not a set of clinical recommendations or a clinical analysis, but something which just challenges that human understanding and empathy.
I'm going to quote another line from the film, from the novel, which I think somehow is very much in sync with the sort of the comedy of the film, the comedic aspects of the film. It's one of the early scenes when Goliadkin Sr. has encountered his double, and he's asking himself, who engaged such a clerk? Who authorized such a thing? Am I sleeping? Am I daydreaming? Mr. Goliadkin tried pinching himself. He even conceived the idea of pinching someone else. And I think just the very act of pinching yourself, again, as with the rubbing the salt in the wounds of yourself, captures that sense, that very disturbed state of, as it were, the bifurcation of selfhood, which is the precise opposite of that healing convergence of your self-attestation, where your I, the I you use of yourself, when you use it in relation to a verb, coincides with the you, the accusative, if you like. The self-attestation coincides with the accusative used by someone else of you, and you recognize your I in the you of another addressed, said of, to you. That convergence is precisely not what we see in Goliadkin's progressive alienation of self from self. And the sort of, and it's fascinating how often he refers to himself in the third person. When talking to other people, he talks about there is, you know, a certain character who is experiencing this at work, and he's talking about himself, so he doesn't use the I. He constantly translates into sort of externalized third-person discourse, which is very interesting. But there's something, seems to me, reparative, if not palliative, about the experience of finding your self-attestation recognisably the same as the accusative used of you, which I think in a sort of inverted, parodic way, both the novel and the film raise as important questions about human flourishing. Who else would like to make a comment? Yes, here in the middle. Do stand, because it'll make it easier for people to hear you.
Question particularly addressed to Richard, though, on the outside thing. It seems clear that we're not actually going to meet the double in real life, but supernatural things don't exist. So, in a way, when we create art, we are somewhat reflecting ourselves back at us. We are sort of seeing a double in the mirror, as it were, sort of like Van Gogh or Picasso and their paintings of themselves. So, with that in mind, I'm curious, Richard, whether you see, you sympathise particularly with either the protagonist of either the film or the book, and sort of more broadly across the panel, particularly to Ben and to Rowan, whether that's sort of where we begin to find a sort of theological inlet for discussion. It's in the process of splitting in self-reflection upon ourselves, where we can start to talk theologically about these mediums.
Do you begin, Richard?
Okay. Well, it's a difficult question to answer. I think in some ways I feel I participated in it rather than, well, I did, rather than author it, in that it is from a novella. I wrote with Avi Kareen, his having done a first draft of the script, in fact more than one first draft, and then I became involved, and you work collaboratively with a number of people, so it never quite feels like a self-attestation to me. It doesn't feel like saying this is a demonstration of my particular interests, but in encountering it, I suppose you reveal what your interests are by the fact that you were interested to do it. But in some ways, and I don't know whether this is in any way answering your question, you try and shut off thoughts of yourself, and that's part of the attraction of writing or directing, in that you're not thinking about yourself, you're thinking about a character, and you're following the consciousness of that person. And one of the joys of reading Dostoevsky is his incredible ability to entirely immerse you seemingly in someone else's consciousness, and then someone else's consciousness directly after that, with the same force and vigor and fluency that he applied to the first one. And that is a thrilling thing to do, and I think probably any reflection of you is in some ways unconscious, or further than that, a failure of getting out of the way of the thing. You know, that really bad writing, you know exactly what the author thinks, I think, because, you know, in the worst example, you can, I used to write a character that was a terrible horror writer, and instead of being able to just do his job, he'd always have to bring in other things, like how annoyed he was about parking, or various things that he would apply to a giant rat attack, and just go, and of course, you know, can get away because of parking permits. And you go, this has got nothing to do with this thing. This, you were annoyed about parking in your life. This has got nothing to do with your creation of it. And so, yeah, I don't know if that's answered your question, and there are more interesting people who should speak now.
On the contrary, but very interesting that you pose that question about self-awareness and the spiritual, if you like. And I think there's something very deeply paradoxical about what most people who have any faith would want to say about their faith. On the one hand, there is a real sense in which a commitment to faith is going to be something to do with self-awareness. You can't entirely grow into it without some sense that, in St. Augustine's phrase, you've become a question to yourself. Quaestio factor sum mihi. I've become a question to myself, says Augustine in the Confessions. And quaestio is not just a question, it's almost something more like an agenda. There's something to work on in myself. But the catch is that the way in which you work on it is eventually exactly what Richard's been talking about, and that's the process by which you you step aside, you suspend this eager, fussy, scratchy, curious ego to let what is come to life in you, whether it's the, you know, the work of imagination in a film, a novel, a poem, or whether it's God. And that's the knife edge. You somehow have to cultivate the kind of self-awareness that allows you to get out of the way as a self. And if that's not a lifetime's job, I don't know what is. It's a very, very odd thing to say. But unless you start by recognizing that yourself is an issue, a problem, you may be so stuck in unconscious self-absorption that you never get to the point of the creative assimilation of what's other, including the divinely other. So I think there is a theological bridge there, certainly.
Can I just pick up, Richard, something you said about losing yourself in the making of the film, and ask how different you feel from the narrator of the novel, who sort of rather mockingly, curiously serves the purpose of often bringing out the humour of the situation, but through this rather sort of mocking set of descriptions in which Goliadkin is repeatedly referred to patronisingly as our hero. Mm. I guess there would have been a temptation as the director of the film to be a bit like that narrator. And to what extent do you feel you were like that, right, or were really losing yourself to the extent that you were not?
Yeah, you mean as in there's a mock heroic address of where you have a triumphalism over very potentially banal and small actions that can exist in the novella and how that's portrayed.
And that in your direction, you're commenting on Simon with a certain sort of knowing, humorous, not unsympathetic, but sort of nevertheless slightly, potentially sort of slightly patronising sense of his limits.
Mm. Well, again, it's probably largely intuitive. It's strange. I'd say that I would probably flippantly say that the film was from Simon's point of view. Mm. But of course, there are times when you know by placing the camera here, it might be funnier. In many ways, it's by degree. You know, there is the worst example of a comment, I think, comically, is a record scratch, you know, because that's something that is completely outside of the world, doesn't exist. What is this record scratch? You know, it's such a comment as, this is stupid. Whereas you're hoping, in a way, to present a window onto what the character's thinking. Mm. And I think, largely, we were trying to be sympathetic to him rather than make him appear ridiculous, and to sort of see him as he saw himself. And so sometimes his ridiculousness is because he is looking at himself in this situation and taking stock and trying to summon up some dignity in response to what has happened. And in some ways that is the position you want to put the camera in. But it's a guess, you know. Yeah. It's how do you translate that exact feeling into a lens and go, I don't know, that level of humiliation is a 32 mil here. You know, it's an odd equation. Mm. But it's one you are mindful of.
Can I ask that question back to Rowan about the novella? Because I was surprised at how sneery the narrator quite often is throughout that, and it seems to me that it is quite problematic in terms of where we then stand in relation to Goliadkin. And I did feel a lot more sympathetic towards Simon, who seems to have, as Richard just said, a level of self-awareness about his own foolishness in a way that, and he's not mocked in the same way that Goliadkin seems to be consistently mocked, not just by the people that surround him, but also by the narrator. Mm.
It's an interesting question, really, because the voice is very like the voice of the underground man in Notes from Underground. As I say, aggressively nasty.
Yeah.
Gleefully nasty, almost. So that I suspect that Dostoevsky is deliberately taking on that voice, saying, well, you know, this is the kind of world in which Mr. Goliadkin lives. This is the way in which his story gets told. By me as well as by everybody else. Hey, you know, this is where we are. So I don't think it's meant to frame our emotional response to Golyadkin as a character so much as to frame our sense of the world in which this is the kind of world in which this story is being told.
I had one thought, which was that also the novella, to me, felt more satirical, that it seemed to in some way say, well, this is a logical endpoint of this kind of petty bourgeois self-aggrandizing where it is important what role you have in this company, that you really want to curry favor. And I agree that although it's third person, it feels first person a lot of the times, and I feel that a lot of the tone is, well, this is how he would refer to him, so as how he would refer to himself, so as narrator, I'm just drifting into his consciousness and showing you how he, in his worst moments, would declare himself to be. With our film, we felt that we weren't really satirizing anyone in that way, that what we were doing was, as you say, more about loneliness, about a lowly person who couldn't break through the prism of his own ego, felt that no one was recognizing him, but the reality is that he's only interested in himself. That's why he's in that situation, partially.
Yeah, no, that's absolutely right. I mean, I very much recognise the tone that Rowan's describing of the kind of nastiness, but I think it's really complicated, isn't it? Even those phrases like our hero, I mean, it could be a sort of sneering version, but it could also be, as Richard's saying, the way Golyadkin thinks of himself. You know, he's being a kind of, or trying to imagine himself as a kind of romantic hero, and then it keeps going terribly wrong. But of course, it's also Dostoevsky parodying previous ways of writing about the central characters. So it brings me back to that idea of a sort of multiplicity of voices, where it's always really hard to locate what the tone really is, or what we're supposed to think or feel about any of the episodes.
Mm. Let me open it to you again, the audience. Okay, well, that's like pause. I'm very interested in. I only spotted this the second time, which may be an indictment of me for not watching attentively enough the first time. But
lack of clarity on the film's part.
There is a moment when Simon gives his shoes to a down and out in the lower part of the building, apartment building where he lives, and it's a curious gesture, which has the odd effect of making him easier to distinguish from James, because he, from that point on, wears a different pair of shoes. He wears these sort of trainers that he keeps normally in his flat, puts on when he gets home from work. And so it's simultaneously an act of divestment, charity, and self-distinction, whereas James remains resolutely throughout in his suit and with the smarter shoes. And that also made me more alert the second time around to the other moments when Simon divests. So he takes his jacket off in the bar on the night out, and James doesn't, I don't think. Mm. He also puts his jacket around Hannah's shoulders when bringing her back from the hospital. Mm. There isn't quite that moment in the novel where Golyadkin sort of becomes, distinguishes himself, sort of starts properly to distinguish himself from the double, except a rather moving speech, actually, in its own terms, where he talks about him being like he's just a rag, but people view him as a rag, but he's a rag with a soul, and no one can see that he's actually got a soul. And it is actually rather sort of, it's a point where he, as it were, appears to merge with the soul, whereas the double remains soulless. Anyway, I wondered how you felt about that decision to let him give his shoes away.
There are a few things with that. Yes, that there are times where he tries to. In the film, there's such a limited wardrobe that people have. They all have more or less the same kind of clothes, and he wears the same things every day. That when he changes what he wears, it's important in some way. For example, in his apartment, he always takes his shoes off and puts these tennis shoes on, which are the same shoes that Hannah wears, in some ways to feel more like her. And he takes his jacket off in front of the picture of the colonel when he first sees him. And so I suppose they're small ways of him trying to alter. I think at that moment there is a charitable aspect, but there's a bit of, well, do I need my shoes for work anymore? I'm on the way out anyway. At least this person can make use of it. So it's, I think there's definitely a recognition of the needs of someone else in that moment, but I think there's also a moment of resignation, which why it felt that's not quite the moment where he has broken through into genuine concern for others, that really only happens, I think, when he sees that when he's about to kill himself and he stops to save someone else, that's the moment where he really tries to not purely focus on his concern. But that was hopefully a step to that realization.
There is, of course, as the novella advances, a sort of progressive divestment going on. Goliadkin Sr., by the end, is in rags, literally in rags, and as he's ushered out, Goliadkin Jr. throws his overcoat over him as if to muffle the identity. But it's almost as if the only kind of distinctness that emerges for Goliadkin Sr. is what happens through suffering. You know, he is visibly suffering. He's visibly humiliated, and that's the awful thing at the end of the novel. He only becomes a self almost as he is stripped, as he's humiliated, and made invisible. The coat thrown over him certainly is distinctive in that sense.
So, going back to the notion of ambiguity. This might be completely off track, but I'm wondering if Hannah, in a sense, actually becomes the double, and that's what, because the film's poster, has anyone got the DVD up here? It's him and Hannah, isn't it? It's not him and him.
Yeah.
And it's interesting that they change shoes, and then, so that he has this, he's wearing her shoes, effectively, and then towards the end, she says to him, doesn't she, I know who you are.
Yeah.
And that's sort of the final moment of recognition, so... Is there a sense in which actually finding a double, a matching half, is not finding yourself but finding someone else?
Yeah.
In a romantic sense, potentially, it's quite romantic.
Yes.
Sort of look at you and see you.
I think there's an element of that. I mean, interestingly, at the end, well, it could be boring, let's find out. At the end of the film, before, there was possibly more of a romantic idea in the writing that some... You know, I guess the most obvious way would have been for Simon to have gone up to Hannah and kissed her or something like that, but it became apparent that what was important was that she recognized him and that he recognized her fragility and I guess on some level, if one is to believe that the double exists in some way, whether psychologically or physically, in a way that Simon's responsible for, Simon has hurt Hannah and Simon has to repair that in some way or recognize his responsibility for how she has been hurt by James. So, and in some ways it felt that the recognition was perhaps important to occur between a male and a female in terms of, I guess Jung talked about the shadow but also the kind of animus and anima, and I guess in terms of Simon becoming a whole persona again rather than just his suit and his position, that I mean, I need to control my hands. that there needs to be a move towards wholeness, which Hannah is a part of, and for her not to just become, yes, the canvas. Mm-hmm. So that was why she was an important character for us.
I think if I remember rightly, his last words in the film are, I'd like to think I'm pretty unique.
Yeah.
Which is wonderful, isn't it? And it, I mean, I just want to say kind of, slightly apropos of that, what a brilliant film it is about photocopiers.
Yeah.
That was the hope.
Which kind of you know, but which is a good example of what I meant by saying, you know, by finding modern ways of getting at real things in the Dostoevsky. I mean, the narrator of one of his earliest stories, Poor Folk, is a copyist. So that idea of sort of, you know, how bureaucracy is so involved in copying, you know, which you've got out marvellously with that sort of rather steampunkish office with a sort of clunky photocopier, was very good. And I think what that seems to me to be about in the novella as well is a sort of two opposed anxieties, really. One is that, you know, we might we might all be the same and indistinguishable, you know, even if we change our shoes, it's kind of not really doing the job properly. But on the other hand, that we might all be so different that we can't communicate with each other. And Goliadkin seems to sort of flip between the two of those all the time.
And that's a theme which is really deeply inscribed in 19th century Russian thought more broadly. How do you cope with the, you know, the two anxieties of absorption and isolation? And whole systems of metaphysics are erected on that with huge complexity. But Dostoevsky is the one who actually embodies the tension.
He wrote in 1861, I think this is very pertinent, that the need to affirm oneself, to distinguish oneself, to stand out, is a law of nature for every individual. It is his right, his essence, the law of his being. And that sort of sense, I'd like to think I'm pretty unique, is in a sense that point made at the end of the film. And it's that question of how we somehow need to make these little flourishes to the otherwise standardized things that we get asked to do day after day in large institutions, not least photocopying. And these little flourishes that make things just actually us, and that it's us doing them, and it couldn't be done by anyone else in quite the way that we do it. And I think one of the really remarkable things is how the world Dostoevsky is describing is so like, in that respect, so like the one that we continue to inhabit, in some ways progressively inhabit.
Except what he didn't understand is that the worst thing is not when the copying happens, but when the photocopy is broken
down. Doesn't work, that's right. We're nearly out of time, but I wanted to just to give the four panellists an opportunity to say any final things that they might have wanted to say before it's too late.
I had a question which was from Rowan's book about the importance of visibility, and just for you to say something about that, because that seemed a very interesting idea in Dostoevsky about, as you're touching on, the flourishes that make you you. And even, I know, partly the sentence was that you're either unique or not, and it felt funny to say pretty unique, because even with that he went, well, I'm not that unique, which seemed funny to us. But just, yes, I suppose I'm just interested to hear you talk about that notion, the visibility one.
Again, towards the end of the novella, when Goliadkin Sr. is, he thinks, hiding in the courtyard while the party's going on in the house, suddenly he realizes that everybody's looking at him from the window. Visibility is both what he craves and what he dreads. And I think that there's a theme in quite a lot of Dostoevsky's work which I'd relate to something that the American philosopher Stanley Cavell talks about quite a lot in his writings, that viable or sustainable, good human relationship is being able to risk being visible, because you trust that you're seen without rejection or without disgust. And that's what he hasn't got. And some of Dostoevsky's characters are really wrestling with that. Of course, in Devils, which to me is simply the most disturbing of his books, as well as the funniest, the crucial, horrible chapter, which was suppressed until the early 20th century, is where one of the central figures, Stavrogin, confesses to Bishop Tikhon his seduction of a 12-year-old girl and her subsequent suicide. And he says, I've got to tell the world about this, I've got to make atonement. And Bishop Tikhon says, I don't think you're serious. What if people just laugh at you? And Stavrogin closes up. He wants to reveal himself on his own terms as the great sinner, but he doesn't necessarily want to be seen. So that's something which Dostoevsky is always feeling his way around. And Cavell, in his wonderful book, The Claim of Reason, talks about how that appears in Shakespearean tragedy, for example, people knowing, not knowing, wanting to be known, refusing to be known, and how that's one way of sort of cutting up the moral world very, very interestingly, I think, so that the essentially good place to be is being able to risk recognition.
Any other final? No?
Well, I suppose, I mean, I like that idea about the visibility and the window, and it did make me want to say something about humiliation, which we've touched on, but it is such an extraordinary novella about that, and the film does it really well too. The way Goliadkin always manages to do not only exactly the wrong thing, but exactly the thing he was telling himself not to do 2 minutes before. And the great moment is when he, in his sort of finery, he bumps into his boss and ends up saying, should I acknowledge him or just, go past and hope he won't see me? And of course, what he ends up doing is coming up with that extraordinary comment, it's all right, it's not me. Mm. And producing exactly the wrong effect, which is, both tragic and comic every time.
I knew that this hour and a half would go far too quickly. There's one whole area of the film that we haven't touched on, which we'll have to wait for another time. But if you do watch it, it's the TV program that Simon occasionally finds himself watching. And if you buy the DVD, watch the deleted scenes or the extended scenes, because there are some hilarious long stretches of that TV episode, which are worth every second of your time to watch. But that is all the time we've got for now. Let me first of all thank Catherine and Max, who are advertisements for what a privilege it is to work with intellectual colleagues at King's, and how interesting they are to work with across disciplines. So thank you both to you. And secondly, to thank Richard and Rowan, doubled on either end of the table. I think one of the things they've displayed to us is that Richard has thoroughly and well-deservedly professorial side when he wants to, and Rowan is a real cineast. So please join me in thanking all four of them.